All right, well, thank you. Thank you so much. It's wonderful to be here. I'm Jennifer Bardi. As Nicole said, I'm the editor-in-chief of the Humanist magazine and humanist.com and deputy director. Can everybody hear me okay? My family says I'm a loud talker, so I guess that's a good thing. I wanted to acknowledge that my location is on the traditional territory of the Piscataway people.
And I'm Kristin Wintermute. As Nicole said, I'm the Director of Education, and I want to acknowledge my location is on the traditional land of the Wapakoot Band of the Dakota Tribe.
I think both Kristin and I feel it's daunting going this late in the game, Kristin, because everyone is so impressive and the presentations have been so good. And we're gonna do a little bit of a casual conversation. Kristin and I are longtime friends and colleagues. And we're gonna have a conversation about the 10 commitments, which was a project developed by the Center for Education. It has some history and really came to fruition in the last year. We're gonna talk about how it came to be and the reception it's gotten from the humanist community. And so I thought we'd start, Kristin, if you could put the graphic up on the screen for people. And Kristin, if you want to just kind of read through the simple titles of each commitment.
Yeah, with each commitment, we do have an I statement, which is kind of hard to read on this graphic. You can see it on our website, ahacenterforeducation.org, more details on it. But the 10 commitments in no particular order, critical thinking, ethical development, peace and social justice, service and participation, altruism, humility, environmentalism, global awareness, responsibility, and empathy.
Great, and we'll get back to that in no particular order.
Yeah.
Item. So first question, and I'm gonna make it, and actually Emily, maybe you could take, if you could take that down for now, we'll go back to that graphic. First question is gonna be a hard one, because you're my friend and I'm gonna do that. And I know that you've been asked this question in various forms a lot. And in answering it, of course, feel free to talk about whatever you want about the how it came about. But really the question is this, so does naming this the 10 commitments elevate Christian doctrine, you know, as the original value set? And simply put, why riff on Christianity's 10 commandments?
Yeah, this is, a topic that has come up. It's a topic of criticism. Why don't we make it 9 commitments or 7 commitments, not to play off of the 10 commandments? I think it's not so much co-opting or positioning us with Christian doctrine as the original and then basing this or going off of that, but more about establishing our own humanist identity, noting what particularly we value and what we stand for. Much in the case like you use, have their 7 principles. The Jewish faith has their 13 fundamental principles, and Islam has its 5 pillars, which all indicate a core belief and practices. The 10 commitments, I think, stand on their own as humanist values to maintain and strive in a daily practice.
Mm-hmm. And I think too, it's worth pointing out that there's a certain marketing appeal to everything, and it's certainly gotten attention, right? And from there, then we can really grapple and delve into what these commitments are. I know earlier in the day during another presentation, there was a comment that respect is not the top humanist value. I think the commenter said empiricism and veritas is. So, but wouldn't you say that these values, the way they're laid out, especially visually, but the way that we think of them as well, they're not hierarchical?
No, not at all. In fact, on the website, we put them in alphabetical order for intentionally, because we don't want to put one value up against like respect or responsibility or peace and social justice. So we thought, well, let's go with alphabetical order so that we're not indicating one is better than the other, but they're all inclusive and they all intersect in some ways. Being empathic may lead to being altruistic or having a sense of humility. So they all intersect.
Mm-hmm. And whose brainchild is this? How did this all come about?
Good question. This brainchild is that of Pripal Kochar. He was the founder of the Kochar Education Center, and he worked with Bob Behrman to bring about these 10 commitments. And for him, it came about, he grew up in India, and in growing up in India, he was surrounded by some of the largest, largest religions in the world: Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, and his own Sikhism. So that is an inspiration. He said, they all have their rules. They all have good points and bad points. And it got him started to think that, as a young person, how do I explain what is being human and what is being humanist? And seriously, he really did say, I could start with 7, maybe 9. Oh, 10's good. And he sat forth to think about what are the essential 10 humanist values. And when I came on to the AHA, bringing the Humanist Institute and forming the Center for Education, what was I going to do with these 10 commitments? And so we sat down and really looked at them and spent like 6 months writing them and thinking about what's important and what's not important. And they're really very broad-based and inclusive, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, yeah, and I think we've talked about how, and we don't really have the time to do this exercise in full, but if you were to, you know, want to take an issue such as race and racism and sort of look at the ways that various commitments can inform your approach to anti-racism would be what we would be approaching. I think it's, you know, there's a lot there, and it's really seems to be resonating with people a lot. I don't know if you know this, but we in the magazine, well, you know that we published a version of a list of these with the graphic, and then you had written kind of a praises on it, and that was the number one read article of the entire year. And then also just in terms of the response, talk a little bit about that. Like, you know, I know people are asking right here today for posters and t-shirts and...
Yeah, I want to speak a little bit to the piece when we did the article and we reintroduced them. People got very excited, and some of them were like, why didn't you put race up there as like a critical value? And I think it is really true that encompassed in these, like peace and social justice, we're talking about equality for all, and then we're talking about race. And when we're talking about being altruistic or empathic or, you know, a sense of humility or, you know, thinking about our own ethical development and how we can move around beyond our own white privilege, as Krista was sort of talking about, you know, challenges of looking at yourself. And I think that the specifics are within, but we didn't focus on the specifics. We focused on a more broad based, so that the specifics are covered, and how you carry out the 10 commitments is really an individualistic type thing. Mm-hmm. I think I didn't answer your particular question. I went off on a bunny trail.
That is okay. You know, we'll have a dance party later. You know? Actually, Emily, if you wouldn't mind putting the graphic back up for a sec, I wanted to... I want to give, well, and I know you want to give a shout out to our art director, Sharon McGill. And just for those of you who are wondering who made all those fantastic videos you've been seeing all day, that was Sharon's work. In terms of the visual, I mean, how large of a role did the visual aspect play, do you think, in sort of really getting people excited about this?
I think it's huge. Sharon's design as an art director was absolutely brilliant, because it isn't hierarchical. It's a circle. It's much like the earth and the planet that we cherish. Not one stands out as, you know, important versus the other, but it's a circle of life. I think her thing was brilliant, and it really brought people in. I will, and we were going to leave this to the end, but I want to put forth that when we were thinking about being in Miami, Jennifer and I were talking about the Wheel of Humanism and that we would have it available for everyone. When you come down for your coffee, you could spin the Wheel of Humanism and whatever you land on, that's what you aspire to on that particular day. And we still may do it, but it was kind of a fun thought.
Of course, we're still gonna do it.
We're gonna do it.
In that analogy, Wheel of Humanism, Kristin, which one of us is Pat Sajak and who's Vanna?
Oh, you're Vanna.
Oh, okay. Now talk a little bit about, because this has also been adapted for children, you know, for younger humanists. And can you fill people in a little bit about that whole aspect?
Yeah, part of when I was thinking early on about, you know, what do I do with these 10 commitments? The original thought was that we would get this in every public school. We would have posters and I was thinking, how do we do this? You know, are people going to reject it because it's kind of a play on the 10 commandments? And the first thought I had was, you know what, if we don't get our own community to get behind this, then how are we going to get the general public to get behind this? And just at that particular time, Jeff Cook, a scout leader in Florida, came forward and said, you know, I have kids in my troop that are atheists and humanists, and they really want to earn their religious emblems badge. What do you think about creating a workbook? And immediately I thought, you know what? The 10 commitments is the perfect foundation for this. Kids working, so we built this workbook based on the 10 commitments with various activities, you know, how to be more empathic, how to be altruistic acts. And we did run it up the flagpole with the Boy Scouts, and this was before the big scandal, and they rejected it. Wouldn't tell us why they rejected it. We all know why they rejected it. But then once the news broke about where the organization had been and is going, we stopped really pursuing that avenue and legitimizing the humanist workbook and badge and the 10 commitments as something with the Boy Scouts. But we continue to provide workbooks. We get requests all the time from campfire girls, from Boy Scout leaders who want their kids to. We have badges available, so once they go through the activities. Also, Camp Quest has this summer, with all the COVID, has taken on the 10 commitments, and they're doing a lot of programming around that, so we're very thankful. Thanks, Kim Newton, and all the facilitators of Camp Quest for seeing the value in the 10 commitments. Mm-hmm. The other really exciting thing that came out of this was a man, a British man associated with the Uganda Humanist Schools Trust, he's a trustee, Steve Hurd, came forward and he said, I really like this. And he was again attracted to the beautiful design and the article I wrote. And we started up a relationship and a conversation. He works with the Uganda Humanist Schools Trust. They have a number of schools in Uganda. And he is a teacher, a professional teacher, and he's been putting together specifically curriculum for that community. And it's been really exciting to see everything he's developing and that his teachers are involved and using the 10 commitments as a foundation. So I'm thrilled.
And also along that, you know, kind of international scope, the 10 commitments people may have seen in the video earlier, the education department video, that it's now been translated into a bunch of languages, and that's an ongoing project.
Mm-hmm. Bulgarian, Urdu, Japanese, Korean. How that came about is the editor of the humanist, Swedish humanist group said, this is great. Can we put this into Swedish? And I was really excited. I was like, yeah, go ahead, go for it. So she took it on and we had a little bit of a back and forth about just words, you know, and meaning, which was kind of fun. And then now it's just exploded. So we have all these different languages and we've sold over 200 posters and we're actually thinking about t-shirts. So I'm excited about that.
are the various translations available for people to see?
Yep. They're online. They're on the hacenterforeducation.org site. Our wonderful art director, Sharon, has made those available. You can download them and see all the different. Also, the artwork is available for download. If you just want to purchase the posters, which they're printed very nicely, you can contact us and we'll help you make that happen.
Very cool. So thinking about, you know, the times we find ourselves in and the reason you and I are doing this in this virtual realm, of course, is because we're in the middle of a pandemic. And, you know, I know that obviously it thwarted the World Humanist Congress and it's upended life all over the globe. And it's, you know, claiming so many lives and livelihoods. I know this is a hard question, but how can we think about applying the 10 commitments to the way we're sort of dealing with this? I mean, how do you think that there's a really practical way we can adapt these to sort of deal with the crisis?
Yeah, I think it's individual and it's very personal. But when I think about, you had sort of posed this question to me and I thought, how would I answer this question? And I started with thinking critically. And one of the things that I have done, I actually live in Minneapolis. So not only did COVID hit, but the city was burning around me. I actually live in a very privileged neighborhood. So I was I was far away from the George Floyd riots, but they also impacted me because I have friends that live in the area. And one of the things I'm thinking about is, and was thinking about the 10 commitments kind of frame for me, critical thinking and learning and reflecting. And as Krista brought up, sort of meditating and really thinking about what are my biases? What are my stereotypes? Where am I not being socially just? Where can I create peace in my own life and be more forward thinking and confront. One of the books that I'm reading is Waking Up White and Finding Myself in the Story of Race. And part of that book is thinking critically about the narratives that we grow up in, mm-hmm. and really challenging those. And I feel like the 10 commitments have grounded me in a way in my humanism that I haven't found before. You know, I've spent 20 years as an educator reading John Dewey, The Common Faith, and all the quintessential philosophical books. But this 10 commitments is sort of bringing my values home and making me grounded and think about what kind of person do I want to be in the COVID crisis? Do I want to be that person walking through the grocery store and not wearing a mask because I'm worried about my vanity? No, I have a sense of humility. I don't care. What I care about is our community, my own health. Yes, of course, my own health. But so I think, did I answer your question?
Yeah, sure. Well, we could talk about it a lot longer. I think this kind of brings us around just full circle, get it, to what this is and what it isn't. I mean, this is to me, it's a very open-ended guide. It's a reminder that even as humanists, who we feel very empowered in our humanism, we feel very confident in our ability to be good, right? And our potential, but sometimes I think we need to be reminded a little bit the best ways to go about that, or just to be reminded to practice some of these things. The critical thinking, I think, comes pretty easily to most of us, but I think all of us, not just humanists, but everybody could be a little more humble for sure.
Yeah.
I think that if people, and we'll say it again, these are not written in stone. If somebody wants to add their own or, you know, tweak it for their own use, that's fine. This is what we're putting out. We're really proud of it. People seem to really, really like it. And congratulations to you guys for seeing it through. I know it was, you know, it took a lot of tweaking. Imagine writing this and then you have to at some point decide on the words.
Yeah. No, that was the hardest part. And I just want to be really clear to the critics. This isn't about dogma and doctrine. This isn't about commanding you how to be a humanist. This isn't about telling what you should or shouldn't do, but maybe getting you to think about committing to your humanism in your daily life. And I think one of the reasons why it really appeals to people is it's a way to practice humanism. And for years, I've been asked from people, how do you be a humanist? You know, okay, we've got 1,000 definitions, but how do you actually be a humanist? I mean, what does that look like? And some of our local groups have been using the posters and the 10 commitments as a way for when new people walk in and they say, what is this whole humanist thing? I don't get this sort of intellectual, what's the heart of the matter? You know, what is this all about? And they've been able to use the 10 commitments to say, okay, this is what it's about. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. To get out of our intellectual heads and, you know, and into the heart of what it is to be human. And for Prapal, that's hugely important, mm-hmm. is not just the humanist aspect, but, you know, how can we be better humans? And he was the mastermind behind this, so.
All right, so shout out to Prapal.
Yay!
Well, I guess we're kind of wrapping up, but I also wanted to say during this coronavirus pandemic, I want to give a shout out to all my colleagues at the AHA. I wanted to acknowledge Nicole Carr, who's really done the heavy lifting with this conference as our coordinator and MC, our executive director, Roy Speckhardt, of course, all the staff, and then, you know, those who are actually working right now, you know, Emily and Peter and Meredith and Ananoshe. If I've forgotten anybody, let me know. But we have managed to do a pretty good job of keeping the ship going during the virus. And I think it's a testament to everybody, but the education department, I will say, has been particularly active. And what else is in store? What's around the pike?
For the education department?
Yeah, for programming. I know you had a meeting last night.
Nicole said a little bit earlier, but we've been doing this, speaking of humanism, which is sort of highlighting humanist leaders and authors. We've started Critical Minds, which is a focus on contemporary topics. We had one last night on the evolution of the brain, which was really fascinating. We're gonna, Jay Hooper, who had spoken earlier, did a Critical Minds on art, imagination, and humanitas, which was really great. He's going to do an instructor-led course furthering what he talked about today and what he did in Critical Minds, which I'm really looking forward to. And Mark Reimers, who did last night's Critical Mind, is also going to do a further reflection instructor-led course. And we've got a lot of stuff in the works, more stuff for Here for Climate, putting together a panel on climate injustice, which we had started in an open lecture series talking about how climate heavily impacts marginalized communities. Mm-hmm. So we've got a lot of stuff coming down the pike. And to the one person in the chat who I referred to the George Floyd as riots, I apologize for that terminology. I should not have used that. I should have said the murder of George Floyd and the uprising and what happened in my community was really life-changing for many of us. And I hope that we continue that trajectory. So I apologize for my misuse of that term and so.
Well, hey, good for you for reading the chats while you're talking.
It just popped up and I felt really bad. So I wanted to, you know, really change my wording. And when people call me out, I need to, you know, acknowledge that was racist framing and to say, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting to consider how these formats change our ability to kind of respond in the moment. I mean, in a physical conference, I suppose that wouldn't have happened, but we are actually at 4:59. So I think we should say goodbye because the award for Humanist of the Year is coming up. But this has been a pleasure, Kristin, as always. Call me.
And thanks everybody for listening. We appreciate you so much. You generate.
Thank you so much, Jennifer and Kristin. That was a very enlightening and interesting conversation. Thank you for telling us all more about the 10 commitments.